thank you. So, so the title of my talk is Modern C Extensions, and that's kind of a lie. I'm actually going to be talking about modern native extensions. And I originally signed up to give a talk about modern C extensions, but I realized as I was learning more about native extensions that you can write extensions in a lot more than C. So we'll get into that a little bit later. As he was saying, I'm a core developer on MyPy. I'm currently in my third year at UC Berkeley. I'm a programming language geek, if you couldn't tell that from the fact that I work on a static type checker. I'm a CPython contributor, and I wrote a PEP about distributing typing information. I'm going to post my slides later on Twitter, at EthanHS, for anyone who's interested. You can find me there. So let's talk about our plan for today. You see these two people? These people are writing native extensions the wrong way. And don't be these people, okay? So I want to help you not pull your hair out when you're writing a native extension module. So first thing we're going to talk about is why write a native extension module? Because, you know, don't needlessly pull your hair out. Then we're going to talk about how you actually write a native extension module. How you ship them, because shipping a native extension module can turn out to be half the work sometimes. And then finally, I'm going to be talking about the future of native extension modules in Python, which hopefully involves less hair pulling. So why would one write a native extension module? I've given three examples here. I think they're probably the most common examples that one can find. The first one is speed. Python is decently fast for most use cases, but in some cases, you might want to write an extension so that you get the optimal speed. Things like C, Rust, C Sharp can sometimes be faster. So a quick survey. Who here has used NumPy, PySide, PyCute, WxPython? Let's see, anything that would involve a C extension. Probably all of you. Python itself is written in C. So a very common use of C extensions in particular, but other things as well, is binding. So a photo here is of the tkinter bindings for GUI programming. It's a very common thing that you have a nice library in another language that you want to use in Python. And so bindings to a native library can be a great reason to write a native extension module. Another one I highlighted, maybe a little bit less common, is safety. If you have some critical part of your code, let's say it's security oriented, you might want some more checks on your code to make sure that it's doing what you want it to do. So you might choose something like Rust or a formally verified language, something like that, where you have absolute certainty, or at least more certainty, that that section of the code is doing what you want. So let's talk about, okay, I've decided I want to write a native extension module. How do I do that? There are a lot of frameworks. This is not an exhaustive list. I mean, I could probably spend 25 minutes just listing all of the different ways that you could write a native extension module. So the question becomes, you know, how do I choose one? They all have their pluses and minuses. Some are better at some things than others. And I think the main two things that I would say you should think about are, what platforms do you want to support? Do you care about performance? And actually, a third would be, is there some specific purpose to choose a certain framework? So for example, if I want the absolute in performance, C types may not be as good of a choice, because C types uses a lot of pointer inflection, and there's a lot of things that happen at the Python level, as opposed to something like Cython, where it generates C code. And so you get very good speed from that. If you want to support an interpreter like PyPy, then perhaps Cython may not be as good of a choice, and maybe you should use CFFI or C types. And if you want to wrap a a complex C++ library, C types isn't going to really do it most of the time. So you might want something like Boost Python, PyBind 11, or Swig. So, and you know, if you're targeting C sharp, there's Python.NET, there's Py03 for Rust. There are many, many options here. So you have to think about, you know, what am I doing, and what are my requirements. I also have a note here to avoid C extensions. And there's one really good reason to do that. And that's this. No one wants to see a segmentation fault. It's an ugly thing to run into, and they're hard to debug. And you know, on the Python dev mailing list, multiple core developers have said that they are discouraging people from using C extensions and instead are encouraging them to use higher level wrappers like Cython or CFFI. So if you love C and you want the utmost in performance, C extensions might be a good choice. So I'm not going to tell you not to use them. However, there are a lot of other really great options. So with that, let's talk about shipping your native extension module. So you have your native extension module. Before we get to that, I want to talk about wheels, because if you are going to ship a native extension module, you definitely should use wheels. So what are wheels? Wheels are a standard for packaging Python code and native extensions. It was specified in PEP 427. PEP is Python Enhancement Proposal. It's a binary that you can download and then gets unpacked into a nice and easy distribution. You can have them per platform, and it makes a lot of things a lot easier. And the main reason to use wheels is that if someone tries to install your code on a platform that isn't supported, they'll get what's called a source distribution. And for a source distribution, for most native extensions, you need a C compiler. And not everyone has a C compiler. So then they get some obscure error where it says, oh, I can't compile this. And you know, maybe they know how to debug that, but maybe they don't. So if you generate wheels, you have a pretty good chance that the person using your native library is going to successfully install your library or program. So use wheels. You can find out more on pythonwheels.com. It has a lot more information about them, but I highly recommend that you use them. Okay, so some other things to think about. Again, think about platforms. This is operating system and also Python version. Are you going to bundle a native library? If you're writing a C types wrapper, perhaps, to a native shared library, you know, that's .so on Linux, .dlib on Macs, .dll on Windows. Maybe you want to distribute that in your package so that your users don't need to install that themselves. And also, what is your build system going to be? You know, if you're building something, if you're building a C extension, then you're probably going to use a C compiler. But if you're using something like Rust, then that might look a little different. So you have to think about these three things. So there are a lot of platforms, as you can see up here. You know, Python 3.3 is no longer supported, so you probably don't have to think about that. 3.4 is ending its life in 7 months, so you may not have to think about that. But 3.8 is coming out in the not too distant future, so that's another thing you have to add to the list. So, if you're supporting Windows, if you're supporting Linux, on top of that, Linux has a lot of distros, and they all have different compilers, and they all have different library versions, and so that can be great. However, that can also be painful if you rely on a shared library of a certain version. And someone on, say, Fedora installs your package, and maybe it's an older version, maybe it's a newer version. But if it's incompatible, then they're going to have a bad experience. So You might see at the top that it says there many Linux. And a many Linux is a format for wheels. And this allows you to cover a lot of those distros that you see up there in a single wheel package. And this makes things a lot easier for distributing your libraries. So instead of targeting, you know, a half dozen or more Linux distributions, maybe, you can just ship one package which will work on most every Linux distribution. So maybe you have to bundle a native library. There are a few tools which can help you with this. The Python Packaging Authority, that's the PYPA, on there, has a tool called Audit Wheel, which will copy shared libraries into your wheel so that it's bundled, and when your user, you know, goes to PyPI and downloads the package, that shared library will come with it. That's mainly focused towards Linux. There's also Dlocate, which does something very similar for macOS. On Windows, things are a little bit less friendly, shall we say. There's a lot of runtime versioning deals, things that you have to deal with, so that's a little bit of a more complicated problem. So that's a lot of things that you have to think about. There's this great program, it's a bunch of templates called CI Build Wheel. And essentially, so I'm going to read this quote. Python wheels are great. Building them across Mac, Linux, Windows on multiple versions of Python is not. So what CI Build Wheel does is it gives templates for Travis CI and AppVeyor CI. And the idea here is that Travis CI can build wheels for many Linux, macOS, and AppVeyor CI can build wheels for Windows. So suddenly, things become a lot easier. As long as you can integrate your build system with this, you can generate all of the wheels that you could need for a library. One note to say about this is that it does not do deployment, so you do have to put in a little bit of work about that. But that can be very, you know, context specific. So to end this talk, I wanted to talk a little bit about the future. Victor Stinner has recently been talking on the Python Dev mailing list and CAPI SIG, which is an email discussion group about the CAPI. And his hope is that he can make the CAPI higher level. There are multiple reasons for this. One of them is that that he can do optimizations in Python so that everyone gets some benefits. On top of that, it makes the CAPI simpler. And hopefully, it can target this magical thing called the stable CABI, which I haven't mentioned until now and deserves some explanation. So with C libraries, you have an API, so that's a C function that you might call. But you also have an ABI, which is where the actual code is in a shared library. The idea behind the stable C ABI is that you can write a native extension, and it will target multiple Python versions. Usually, you can only target a single Python version because there might be a new function that's added, or something might get deprecated and removed. But with the stable ABI, you can have a single extension work across multiple versions. So why am I not saying, you know, use the stable ABI? I mean, you know, like we just talked about all of those versions of Python that you might have to support. Well, right now it's a little bit complicated to use it. It can take a fair amount of work. Not many people target it. But hopefully, with a higher level C API, it could make it easier to target the stable ABI, which makes your job of shipping a library a lot easier. Additionally, there is a newer version of the many Linux specification called many Linux 2010. The way many Linux works essentially is it uses a lowest common denominator of all of the Linux distros that distributions that that you could probably want to target. Unfortunately, or fortunately, these distributions have a tendency to update. And so with newer distributions, the C runtime is newer, and so maybe you want to take advantage of that. In addition, the many Linux building Docker containers are based on a old version of CentOS, which is no longer supported. So there are several reasons, but this should make it a lot nicer to build many Linux wheels in the future. There's been some talk on Twitter about potentially having official support for the Rust programming language, which is which I would be very glad to see. You know, it probably is, you know, down the road if it's going to happen, but you know, it could happen. There's the great Pyo3 library, which already exists, but maybe that could get integrated into the standard library. And finally, it's possible, there's been a little bit of discussion on the mailing lists about a Cython-like tool in the standard library. For those of you who don't know, Cython basically is, you can write things that are kind of like Python, but with some type information, and then it will generate C code. And so it's a way to write a native extension without needing to actually write C code or Rust or something like that. So you get a lot of niceties of Python and also more speed. So this is in the distant future because they would need to figure out what that would look like, you know, how it would be integrated. They'd need to iterate on it a lot, but this could be a really nice way to make it easier to write native extensions if you need to speed up a certain part of your code base, for example. So with that, I will take questions. Thank you very much.
I want to know, are there some tools to automate some of the process from going from C to being able to call it in Python? This is still a lot of like overhead of writing the wrappers.
Right. So you want to write an extension, like a new extension, and you're not wrapping a library. Okay, so you have some C code that you just want to use. So if you have some C code you want to use, you have several options. I mean, CFFI is really great because you can essentially copy the declarations, and then it will automatically generate bindings to it. You can also use Cython, which you essentially say, oh, import these functions, and then you can call them, and that will generate a C extension for you. So it's essentially automating writing the C for you in many ways. It definitely minimizes the amount of boilerplate that you have to do, yes. Yes, yes. Any other questions? I know I went through a lot.
Is there a nice comparison table for all of these different implementation methods?
All the frameworks?
Yeah.
So there have been various blog posts and articles over the years. There's nothing up to date currently. That would be something that would be great to have. As I said, there are a lot of different reasons to use different ones. So there would be a lot to cover, but that would definitely be a very welcome thing to see. Any other questions?
Anymore.
Oh, down here? Oh.
Are there any plan for Python to target with like a WebAssembly? Will that affect the C, you know, extension as well?
I'm sorry, can you repeat?
For the WebAssembly, are there any plan for Python to target to the WebAssembly, and will that affect the future of you know, C Python design? For example, Rust have the WebAssembly backend kind of thing. So.
Right, right. So I don't know of any official plans. I do know that there are several unofficial builds of Python for WebAssembly. For those who don't know, WebAssembly is a binary target for the web, which is very portable. So I don't know of any official plans. I don't see it being too much of an issue because of the semantics of WebAssembly. It should definitely be possible to keep the current C API semantics. Any other questions?
Thanks. What if you only have the .so or a DLL, you don't have headers and code, but you still want to wrap that? Is that possible?
Yeah, definitely. So that would be an excellent case where something like C types might be good. Or I believe CFFI can also be used for that. Both of those can call into to already existing binaries.
This is sort of a more technical one. So once upon a time, I have actually needed to write a C extension. Yes, with actual C.
Okay.
And it worked. I'm pretty sure it worked. But is there anything that could help me verify that I got my reference counting correct?
Yes. That's a major area. If it doesn't, you can avoid seg faults, but you also have to think about memory management when you're writing a C extension, which is another thing to think about. There exists a GCC plugin to track reference counting. It's old and it hasn't been updated in a while, but I did look at that. I've also thought about writing one based on Clang. But the GCC plugin probably would be your best bet.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? All right. So let's thank Ethan for this awesome talk with a round of applause.